I've been doing evaluations for 20 years, and one of the more interesting things about evaluation is that you're generally not welcomed when you go into a community, etc. It sort of inspires a little bit of dread. Part of what I'm going to talk to you, I've got about 22 minutes to make my presentation, about 8 to 9 minutes for a discussion. In my experience as an evaluator, what I want to share with you, sort of some simple questions I ask when I evaluate programs. And part of what I hope to share with you is the idea that the standard cookie-cutter approaches, where here's the best method to evaluate a program, is fundamentally problematic. So point number one, the complexity of what you're going to be evaluating matters. That's one. So my own focus is going to be on place-based programs. You have to think about, a doctor needs to know what disease he or she is dealing with before you prescribe a medicine. Far too often in evaluation, we move towards best methods without thinking through about what is the nature of our intervention. That's one. Two, most of my own doctoral training was on methods and measures, et cetera, et cetera. I used to be in the United States for many years. I evaluated once a $30 million evaluation itself, where basically when you actually went to the community, people did not have a clue about how the program was going to be implemented. And my job as an evaluator was to measure away for 5 years and then come back with the rather bad news, this ain't working. I thought there's fundamentally something problematic about the way we think about evaluation if all we are worried about is, does it work? Now, clearly in an age of accountability, you have to answer the question, does it work? But I'm also going to be arguing that you have to understand, how is something going to work? And that, to be clear with you, in graduate school, that was not part of my training at all. My training was just go in, what's the best design, what's the best method, answer the questions. But more and more, I've sort of realized my role as an evaluator is to ask questions about how can things work. I'm going to talk about community interventions. That's fundamental. Because even the so-called same program means very different things in very different communities. So part of what I'm going to argue about is you have to be honest about the complexity. But not my hope here is that in the act of raising these questions, you don't get so deep into it that you cannot answer any questions. There's a risk in what I'm going to tell you. What I'm going to sort of share with you are sort of 10 things that I think about when I evaluate a program or a policy. And I want to be super clear about this. I don't do all 10 of them. These are things I think about. In the actual movement towards what to do, I may do 3 or 4, maybe 7, depending on the circumstances of it. Okay? There are sometimes somebody wants an answer day after tomorrow, or wants an answer 3 months from now. We cannot do the same thing for that as compared to something that we have a little more time. Okay, so these are really rules of thumb. So let's sort of start with just a basic definition of evaluation. So the definition here is good enough. Both as a, evaluation is defined both as a means of assessing performance and to identify alternative ways to deliver. That's exactly the kind of definition you're here to address. I'm actually going to argue with you, that's not good enough. My own experience as an evaluator is some of the biggest contributions we can make when we evaluate is develop a better understanding of how on earth could the program have worked in the first place. My own experience with evaluation, this is like Mark's comments about logic models, etc., but I'm not really sure whether the problem is just with the logic models. I would argue it goes beyond that. We have not thought through what's a good enough plan that can be implemented, okay, whether it's expressed through a logic model, et cetera, et cetera. So the surprise is we go in to implement a policy or a program. And once we come to the implementation, people are completely dumbfounded. What do we do about this? What do we do about this? Often our blueprint of programs are missing. And where I like this, where this conversation is going, is we need a better vocabulary of how do we know this program is good enough to be implemented. So let's sort of start with the basics. That's the other confusion about evaluation. There's one crowd in evaluation that says, well, if you cannot answer, does it work, does it not work, it's not an evaluation. That's one view. But remember, one very strong view, and that's what usually pays the funds, is assess the merit and worth of a program. So this is where we get into the causal debates. Do we need a randomized study? Do we need an observation study? Et cetera, et cetera. But I want to stress this, that's only one purpose of evaluation. A second purpose that's quite important, I would say incredibly critical when you're dealing with very complex programs, is to provide feedback, to do a more formative evaluation. Okay, that's two. Three, sometimes, I used to be in Scotland for many years. In Scotland, we implemented a very strong smoking ban. The smoking ban is not going to work if bars and other working places don't implement the program as it's meant to be implemented. So you do oversight and compliance. Finally comes something that I think is very, very critical, and this is where I think let's call a spade a spade. Many of our programs and policies are implemented without clarity on how they're going to work, or how on earth are they going to impact people's lives. And that's where I think evaluation has to raise those questions. I've done far too many evaluations. I almost think it's unethical to be evaluating for 5 years and simply saying at the end of it, it does work or doesn't work, without providing greater clarity on how to do it better. Okay. So this is where I disagree with a simple distinction between research and management. No, we are in this without those labels. You have to answer at the end of it, how can things improve? And I'm arguing even the evaluation methodology community is so divided, etc. I think we need a better discourse that actually integrates monitoring and evaluation and other ways of thinking about it much better. So here's an example, and this was an example I actually spent 3 years sort of thinking about this problem and evaluating this problem. The focus was Scotland, and the focus was on, look at the right-hand side of it, the focus was on reducing health inequities in Scotland. Okay? What the government of Scotland said was the way to approach reducing health inequities is focus on 15% of the poorest areas of Scotland. So they targeted this large national demonstration program at 15% of the poorest areas. Now their hope was by doing community programs, by doing other kinds of ways to reach the poorest people in the poorest area, folks would come through the door. There'd be a lot of other interventions that I won't describe right now. Their hope was their own conditions would improve, as a result of which their heart risk decrease over time. Their hope was over time this would lead towards health equities. Now notice the fact, the critical part out here is not the logic model or not. There's a deep assumption being made out here. The assumption here is by focusing on the poorest areas, you're going to get the poorest people. Okay, guess what? You don't need a five-year evaluation to tell you, guess what happened? The program was implemented within the first 6 months. Guess who was coming through the doors? It was not the folks who needed the program. Okay? So the assumption that poorest areas, by targeting poorest areas, you get poorest people, that's problematic. Okay? So right away, I want to sort of say, the interesting story, I'm kind of mindful of the time, but what is really interesting, the learning of the evaluation was not simply, did this program work in terms of impacting health equities? No, it could not have worked because your model of reach in itself was problematic. And there's a story for another day. But what was really interesting was the government of Scotland began implementing a bunch of other models of similar, using similar models of reach. Within the first 6 months of the evaluation, we could feed back to the government to say, actually, you've got this model wrong. You need to do something better. Okay? So I want to sort of stress this evaluation, learning from evaluation does not just come from, did we hit a home run in terms of outcomes? You've got to be looking into the black box. And I want to stress again, I was not taught that as a graduate, as a student at all. In my first 10 years as an evaluator, my focus was, what's the best method? I think we've got to have, again, as I said, a slightly more interesting conversation. So this was an example of a federal program from the Human Resources and Skills Development Canada, and this is an example of where I think the logic model leaves a lot to be desired. So this is the government's view of the logic. I won't go into all of this stuff, but the important point I'm making here is not how you visually represent anything, but do we really know what the heck we are talking about? Okay, that's really the bigger point. And I'm not sort of, this does not necessarily mean, that's why I'm not sure, this is in itself the problem with the logic model. It's the problem that I think is far bigger. Are our planning documents that we've just said, let's spend $30 million on such a project, do we know this is good enough to be implemented? So this is where I'm sort of raising in terms of evaluation. These are the kinds of discussions I'm having. Okay? So I won't go into too much, but and this is a slightly academic slide, I won't spend too much time in it, but I want you to think about is every program, and sort of think about your own program, think about how your program brings about change. So without getting academic on you, remember, most of what you're doing in terms of programs, if we do this, then this will happen. if we do this, if that happens, this will happen. And that's where you need a measurement system to sort of say, is there evidence that's actually happening? Okay? But I want you to see every program that you're interested in, including the one you decided to spend 3 days out here, is based on a theory that you're going to find something useful out here. It's an empirical question whether that's really the case. Okay? So this is, you could have been doing other things right now instead of being out here. You made a theoretical decision based on all things considered, may not be a bad idea to come here. Our programs that we implement to change our world around us make trillions of if-then decisions. And I'm sort of arguing part of evaluation's job, without getting caught up in the complexity of it, is to say there are some critical things out here that really need to be questioned. A couple of questions from that side about unintended consequences. That's the other part. More and more, we are so stuck with our framework. So part of the questions we ask is really, in the act of intervention, did we create a bigger problem? Okay, so we are too much in love with our own interventions, forgetting that most of the people's lives we're trying to change have a trillion other problems. Your intervention might be the biggest thing for you. It's one of 10,000 other things they have to worry about. Okay? The other thing we don't do a good job about taking the program or the policy as a unit of analysis is, remember, all our programs in our communities, for example, are one part of a larger system. If the system itself is not that supportive, it could be a problem. So here's a person who's sitting in something resembling a cubicle, thinks he needs to do something to feel a little freer. It turns out it's not a good idea. Okay? So the point being, you've got to pay attention to the structure. All right, so this is all. So part of the 10 questions I ask are the following. The first set of questions I ask are really about, do you actually know how the program is going to bring about change? Okay. Let's, even before we spend too many dollars. So, by the way, part of the center we started, the Evaluation Center for Complex Health Interventions, we don't take up a project if we are not part of the process early on. So we have that luxury right now, I realize, but it's really critical. I've done far too many evaluations where somebody says, we've spent $10 million already, we have a report due by March 31st, can you come do an evaluation in the next 20 days? It's hard to do that, by the way, to do it honestly. So the questions I ask is, number one, are you clear about, if I was part of the process, what are the different components of your program? I cannot tell you, does a program work if you cannot even answer what are the different components of a program? This sounds incredibly trivial, but you could not be more wrong. As an example, I'll be blunt about it, there was a provincial ministry that was implementing a very large complex program that they already implemented 3 years ago. They said, can you help us do an evaluation in the next 1 year? I said, well, tell me a little bit more about your program. We were sitting across a table, we had 3 hours allocated. They said, can we get back to you about that next week? Can we get on to the evaluation? I said, no, we cannot. You have to tell me a little bit more about your program. A week went, 3 weeks went, then they sent me a 400-row Excel file that said, our large, this huge initiative consists of all these different programs, but we are not yet sure. I said, I probably cannot do an evaluation in the next 6 months, et cetera. That's one. I don't have too much time, but the question of, if you want to know, some of the components may be changing over time. Part of implementing programs in communities are not, there's very rarely this fantastic blueprint that says, this person gets 2 bananas and the other person gets 3 oranges. No, it doesn't work that way. There's a sort of learning in the community, adaptation that's going on. That has a fundamental implication on the kind of design you adopt. Okay, that's one. Two, I think, call it what you like, a program is not going to succeed if somebody doesn't know how it's going to work. If you need to get from here to San Francisco, it's probably a good idea you chart out what your roadmap looks like. Okay? It's probably a good idea you know there are immigration requirements across, if you're driving, across, I guess any which way you go, that there are, you need to figure that out. Far too many programs are done with 20-page descriptions of, and this is where the scientific community is not helpful. We have this sort of myth about, it's an evidence-based program, implying it's so easy to implement. No, not true at all. So getting that clarity is very critical. The evaluation community, I think, has a responsibility to raise those kinds of questions. That's two. Three, it's very critical, and I won't go into the details of it. Your program is probably not the first time this program has been implemented. So you have to beg, borrow, steal from what's out there to say, actually, there are some tricks of implementation. We can learn from another implementation that's happened in Sudbury. Why not? Why do you want to go through 5 years of failure and then write the grand report that sort of says the program failed, when you could be part of such a process? So a lot of people say, actually, that's not the role of evaluation. I would say that's fine. There are different projects, different focuses, where your job will have to be just to wear the white lab coat, etc. But I'm sort of saying this certainly is a role we are centers playing for different kinds of programs. The fourth one is actually quite critical. This was a real surprise to me. When I was in graduate school, we were taught use time series methods, use randomized studies, etc., etc. And when I began to actually implement evaluation, so this is a true story, in the Department of Justice, we had a large project. I was working in the Urban Institute, and we were evaluating a very large project from Department of Justice in the US, where the focus was doing community place-based interventions, community collaborations, in the hope that this would improve community crime, in terms of measures of community crime. So my most obvious question was, how long will this program take to implement community crime? Because this is not an overnight problem, especially if arranging a meeting sometimes takes 4 to 6 months. And you know, you're all familiar with this problem. How is it that in 1 year we can report back community crime did not increase or did not decrease? So I said, this is common sense. My 70-year-old will sort of start with asking that question. And the surprising thing was, so I actually did an experiment. I talked to funders, I talked to academics, I talked to community groups. And I said, tell us, how long do you think this program can actually take to impact community crime? Turned out the funders and the academics were like 2 to 3 years. The community groups said, no, we've been implementing for many years. It takes about 5 to 7 to 8 years. Now, this is important. Why? Because your views on whether the program was successful fundamentally depends on how long did your evaluation run. Most of our evaluations for these complex interventions run for a year or two or three at most. And that's our accountability requirements. On the other hand, some of this change for depending on the nature of the complex program. So you can certainly say, hey, geez, we've got accountability requirements. We don't have 7 years, 10 years. I agree with you. But I think part of doing an honest job is to say, if getting from here to San Francisco is not an overnight problem, don't say, guess what? We drove for 3 hours and we only reached Buffalo. That's the nature of your roadmap. Okay? So very often, I think, by not raising these questions, we're doing a disservice. So that's one set of questions. Notice the fact I've not moved to. And by the way, I've got to say, I don't do these 10 things in a linear way. I jump around. I'm presenting this in a very linear way. Two things. I'll start with the second of the things. Different stakeholders have different questions of the evaluation. Okay? Far too often, we assume there's only one type of question. I don't start an evaluation without trying to get the stakeholders around and say, actually, let's see what the questions are. And here's the catch. And here's the bad news. I cannot answer them all. But that's not going to be possible. These are all rich. Let's go through a process of prioritization. I'm right now working with a project with IDRC and a Canadian Institute for Health Research. This is a tough process of prioritization to say, actually, no, I don't want you to complain 2 years from now that my report answered these questions unsatisfactorily, because I'm telling you right now, to do a good job, I can answer a few questions, but let's go through a process of prioritization. The other part, I think, almost never gets done. Most of our evaluations are written. So I'm really presenting an idealistic view of evaluation. The good news is it can be done. The bad news is it can be done rarely. I see the tide changing. I like answering the question, how will the evaluation itself help improve the program? Is the focus purely accountability? Or if we say accountability and learning, what the heck does learning mean? Tell me the mechanism of learning. Tough question, but a useful question the third time you raise it. Okay. So then we come to a more conventional view of evaluation. And to be clear, this is often the bread and butter of evaluation. So the first 6 points, you say, Sanjeev, that's great. Thank you. You've sort of spoken to me. But guess what? I still got a job to do, is what you're thinking. Yeah. And so you're going to say, well, funder wants to know fundamentally what was the impact of the program. There's a question on what's the best design out here. There was a response from that. There was a comment from there. Very, very important question. We've got to engage with it. And again, I'm arguing we've got to be opportunistic about it. If for a certain intervention we can bring a certain design in a low-cost way, let's go for it. Okay, but I'm arguing far too often we move to step number 7 without thinking through the earlier steps. And here's where it gets unethical. If you don't answer the question about how long will things change, and then say after 1 year this community intervention did not improve community health indicators, I think that's wrong. Okay, so that's 7. But 8 is the other important part. How did your own view of the program change as a result of implementing? Far too often, we think of evaluation as a best buy. Thumbs up or thumbs down. Let's buy a Toyota or no to a Toyota. In actuality, the actual processes, as we implement complex interventions in our communities, your own, at the end of 3 years, and you've all worked with community groups that said, actually, I wish I knew now what I didn't, I knew 3 years ago what I know now. Why don't we build in that sort of system itself? Okay, it's idealism. 9 and 8 is a little, again, furthermore utopian, but here's the big con of evaluation. Too much of evaluation focuses on, does this program work? The pretense, especially for pilot programs, is then as a result of this program, we can generalize it all across Scotland, all across Canada. The big con in evaluation is evaluation methodology has not seriously spent time trying to say how do we generalize from a certain specific program to the broader issue. Far too much we have focused on questions of causality. We have not focused on what I'm calling spread out here. What actually gets spread? So in my Have a Heart Paisley case in Scotland, the assumption was as if we hit a home run in Paisley, we're going to implement 22? Okay, I'll wrap up in a minute. We're going to implement this all across Scotland. That's nonsense. Why? Because if you don't have enough money to sustain the intervention in Paisley, which is a very small part of Scotland, how can you implement the same program all across Scotland? So more and more I'm asking, what do you plan to what can be spread out here? Turns out it's not just the program. It could be a variety of different kinds of learning. Okay? The final comment I want to make is, my assumption as an evaluator was, hey, geez, as a result of the evaluation, we are going to decide whether the program should be sustained or not. I'm arguing, actually, rather surprisingly, for very complex place-based interventions. That view could be very good for sort of aspirin kinds of intervention. I think we need a much more deeper dialogue early in the intervention to sort of say, early in the evaluation itself, what role will this evaluation play in deciding to sustain this intervention? Okay, the pretense is, you just produce the report, we'll go through our processes in Ottawa, and we'll decide whether to extend it. Okay? I don't think it works that way. Let's be honest about, maybe the evaluation has only a smaller role. Let's be more specific about it. I'll stop here. Questions?